adopted. And you, I was a big fan of Rudy Giuliani long before the world really knew about
before
you.
Before anybody else was. Before,
well, you know, well, in your tougher hours right. as mayor, when you were under
when
a lot
of fire.
I used
to hold a press conference a day.
That's true. L.A. Times, December 21st, says, word around New York is former Mayor Rudy Giuliani has decided to challenge Hillary Rodham Clinton when she seeks re-election in 2006.
That is not correct. I haven't made any decision at all about 2005, much less 2006.
Are you thinking about
it? No, actually, I'm not. I'm not thinking. I'm not going to think about it until after the presidential elections. I think my focus right now is going to be on doing everything I can to re-elect President Bush and Vice President Cheney. I help around the country.
You want to run again. You want, you
and
love then, politics. It's in
and
your
then
blood.
I've got plenty of time to make a decision on, you know, do I want to run again? What do I want to run for? Yeah. Senator, governor, who knows? I don't know.
It'll all happen. Maybe president?
You know, that's something you don't really think about when there isn't the possibility of doing it coming up. And right now, my focus is on getting president.
I've known you for a lot of years, and I know you have very keen, astute political instincts. As you handicap this presidential year, this race, the economy's turning around, the president's had moral clarity and great instincts in the war on terror. Where are his areas of vulnerability?
To the extent that I'm a political expert, I think the president is in a very, very strong position. Yeah. To the extent that I'm a good friend of the president, a big supporter, and a loyal Republican, I worry about the election. Because I did it myself. I ran for re-election at a time in which I thought I was in pretty good shape to be re-elected, but I ran as if it was a one-point election, because you never know what can happen. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the way the president has to approach it. And honestly, I think when you step away from it, you have to look at it that way. Politics changes very, very quickly nowadays. I can't even, I was listening to your show before, I can't handicap the Democratic race. I mean, right now, Howard Dean looks like he's in a very strong position, but there are a lot of things that can change.
It can happen.
Yeah. Okay.
300 days to the election, you're right, a lot could change.
A lot can change.
So Rudy Giuliani, thanks for being with us. Let's go to Washington with Greta Van Susteren.
I can't believe what I have to say about you tonight. It's something I've never said before. But first, 35 U.S. troops were wounded today after a mortar attack near a base just to the west of Baghdad. A Pentagon spokesman said that some of the wounded were hospitalized while others returned to action immediately. But are we seeing a general decrease of violence since the capture of Saddam Hussein? Joining us now, the host of the ever-popular War Stories and the author of a terrific new book, New York Times best-selling book and author, War Stories, Operation Iraqi Freedom. And it comes with a DVD, and I'm in it. I'm very proud of that, Colonel. How are you, my friend?
Good to see you. Happy New Year, Sean.
Happy New Year. All right. I was saddened to hear about the attack today. Do we have an indication that these attacks are lessening because of the capture of Saddam?
Well, yes. Short order, things are a lot better in Iraq than we've even believed before he was captured. And since he's been captured, you've seen the roundup of literally hundreds of mid-level and high-level Ba'athist leaders. You're also seeing increased willingness on the part of the Iraqi people to turn in the so-called foreign fedayeen and those Ba'athists that are still out there. The bottom line, until we get this ammunition problem, of which there are literally hundreds of millions of tons of ordnance that have been splattered around that country by Saddam Hussein. I once described him on your show when I was reporting from over there, Sean, that he was the Imelda Marcos of military ordnance. He never saw a bullet he didn't like, bought millions of them.
Yeah.
And of course, what you're seeing is the need to get that stuff collected up so they can't shoot it at us.
All right, now you were with the guys, you knew the guys that were responsible for finding him in this hole that he was hiding in, cowardly as he was. We now have had him in custody for some time. We had biological weapons labs that we found botulinum toxin, not the WMDs we wanted. Are your sources telling you we're getting closer to extracting more information from him?
Well, in fact, some of the things that you're hearing is very, very disparate. But I just talked a few minutes ago, just before we came live here, with one of my friends who's in this business. Tells me a number of things. Number one, you've got CIA, FBI, and DIA interrogators who are grilling this guy literally around the clock. They're pursuing the leads that they get from this elsewhere, and that includes neighboring countries and inside Iraq. Interestingly enough, most of the really good information that Saddam Hussein has provided came as a consequence of the information he had packaged up in those three farmhouses in the vicinity of the rat hole in which he was hiding when he was captured. And lastly, one of the things that they're really trying to get out of him, and it appears, at least from what I was told here earlier this evening, that Saddam Hussein probably doesn't know the full depths of it himself is the relationship that his government laboratories had with other countries, particularly with France and Germany. There ought to be people in Germany and France right now hoping that Saddam Hussein has a case of amnesia, particularly Jacques Chirac and Gerhard Schroeder.
Ollie North, let me come back to what's going on here with this insurgency for a second.
Sure.
You know something about combat, and you know a lot about insurgencies, having served in Vietnam. Does it bother you that that Donald Rumsfeld and the Pentagon planners didn't really adequately plan to clean up the arms that you just talked about and have an aggressive effort to thwart that insurgency before it got started? I mean, there was no question we were going to win this war.
Well, actually, you've got two different things happening here. Number one, what bothers me even more is the fact that our intelligence on what was going on inside Iraq was so bad.
Why was it so bad?
Before this war started.
Why do you think it was so bad?
Pat, I don't want to blame you personally, but if you look at what has happened to the CIA for the last 30 years, it has been a political football that's been kicked all over Washington, particularly by the Congress, and basically since the 1970s, we have not had an intelligence agency worthy of the name. So we had zero human intelligence going into this war. We knew nothing. For example, one of the generals that I interviewed just a few short weeks ago in preparation for going back yet again told me, General Conway, he said, the day that the war started, the 20th of March, we knew where every single Iraqi armor piece, every single artillery piece, every tank was. We didn't know a thing about the thousands of fedayeen who had come in from Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, Saudi Arabia, and all the other places around that were willing to fight and wanting to die to kill Americans. And we knew nothing about it. That's human intelligence. We had great overhead reconnaissance. We got satellites that can read license plates from 100 miles in the sky, which is great if you're going to be attacked by a license plate. But when you're being attacked by terrorists, you don't know anything about it.
Great book, by the way, War Stories, Amazon.com, bookstores near you, and watch the DVD with it. Thanks, Colonel. Always good to see you. And War Stories every Sunday night at 8 p.m.